Welcome to episode 13 of our Eagles Nesting series, while we all stay at home to protect the NHS and social care and save lives during this coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic. We hope you are well and everyone and all your loved ones are too. And what's a great series of memories we've had so far across all of the Nestings, and we've got loads more to come. Tonight, we have another very special episode. Tonight, it is a double. We have got the 2012 BBL Trophy first and second legs in that finals series for you tonight. First away at Plymouth Raiders, then back home at Sports Central. You can see both of these games back to back, slightly shortened version of the first leg. So you can see the swing in this game on the Nesting coming up. If you're on our YouTube channel, you'll see all of the action straight after this interview with some of the people involved in that game. Or if you're on our Facebook page, watch the interview and then you can jump over there afterwards. So it is our Eagles against the Plymouth Raiders again. Thanks to the Raiders for letting us use their footage of that first leg from Sunday, the 18th of March, 2012. The second leg, well, it's back at home at Sports Central for us the following Friday, the 23rd of March. Tonight's guests need no introduction, but as we've built up a little bit of a format on the Nestings, we'll do that anyway and now welcome them in order. Firstly, to guide us through this next chapter in our Nesting series and that clean sweep season of 2011-12, please welcome back our assistant coach, Dave Forrester.
Thank you. I think I've now set the record. I've got four.
And former player now joining us again from the game you're about to watch, joins us from the US right now. Joe Chapman, welcome back.
Thanks, man. Thanks for having me. It's good to, reminisce a little bit and enjoy this.
And it gives me great pleasure to welcome back our former player head coach joining us again from Canada. Welcome back, Fab Flournoy.
Yeah, it's great to be back. What's up, Joseph?
This is about to be fun.
sorry, Dan, who's he?
It's so great to have you guys all together, and I know it's great for you guys to be able to catch up as well. As while we're all staying at home, we're all sharing these memories, and a lot of the players have enjoyed speaking with each other. Dave, to set the scene as we go back to these two very exciting legs of basketball that we've got coming up on Nesting tonight. We did lift the cup, as we saw in the last Nesting against Plymouth. They were very strong in this season, but now we're going into the second of our four silverware wins in this clean sweep. They are tough competition, aren't they?
Oh, absolutely. They had some very talented players, and they had a lot of finance behind them that year. And they went around the league and they picked up some really, really solid players. It was also something of a unique season because it was, I think, the only season that the league had a two-legged final in the trophy, which meant that because we'd been higher than them the previous year, we got the second leg at home. And we played them on the Sunday and then the Friday. And it's actually the only one-off trophy that we actually won at Sports Central. We won the league a couple of times there, but the only one-off game that we won at Sports Central was this one. And it was probably the loudest, the second leg was probably the loudest that I can actually remember Sports Central, because it was absolutely ram-packed for that game. The season had really went very well. We had a short roster. We only really played seven guys most of the time. And Joel Maduri and Ross Wilson were, and Lamar Morrison were kind of our young guys. But the seven players really gelled. And just after Christmas is when they got healthy. We got healthy. We went to Holland at Christmas, had a good time, played a lot of games, and then came back. And we all saw what happened in the cup final, where we basically... We beat Plymouth pretty soundly, scored 115 points. And they didn't go away at that point. They made the way into the trophy final, and they were out there after us for another shot at us. And, it's a tough place to play Plymouth because it's 400 miles away. And we had to go down there first, then we had to come back for the second leg. And we got their best shot, I think, in the first leg. And when they came back to our place in the second leg, it was a little bit different. Very close, though. The game was in doubt until the very end. So, I don't know what Fab remembers about Plymouth or Joe remembers about Plymouth, but we all have our memories.
Oh, man. Yeah. Joe, I'll let you go whenever you're ready.
Oh, well, so they didn't go away.
The score is, I cannot think of a single player or even coach on our team over 10, 11 years who hasn't had some sort of meltdown in Plymouth. It's everybody at some point. They're loud and the lights are there and the distance of travel and all of that stuff. It just kind of throws you off where you're going. And the fox dancing around and all of that, So we've all had our moments. To be absolutely fair, Plymouth, and I will be fair, Plymouth, their ownership has now changed, and the organisation is a far different organisation to what was going on at the time. the story that it became a we were certainly motivated to win, but also there was lots of things going on. The Pavilions is really a theatre. It's where they play their games. But it's a theatre, first and foremost, not really a sports venue. And we have great fans, and we have fans who travel 400 miles to go to a game. And one of the games, they actually were met by a bit of paper which had been placed on their seats and nobody else's seats, only 10 seats. Basically saying, please don't make too much noise.
Right.
And don't stand up. At that point, it was like, what are we doing? What is going on here? It's a basketball game. You've traveled 400 miles to pay your money to come and, support the league. And you're being told to sit down and shut up. that really, if I remember, that was quite a big point. I think we all took that a little bit personally because we all support our fans a lot. We appreciate them. And if they were being kept like that, we weren't very happy at the time, I think.
Well, and then, we started gelling pretty quick there. After that Holland trip, I think everyone, just started to get to know each other a little bit more, crack some jokes, get to know each other, on that trip. And, that helped us form that bond between those 7-8 guys that we had, because we, like Dave said, we didn't have a big bench that year. We just all knew each other's role, and like the guy said before, I think Charles and Paul was on, they were just saying that whoever got top, we kind of knew this was their game, and we kind of rode the wave. I think Fab and Dave did a great job of rotating people in and out and keeping people in the right roles that they had. So that year was pretty special, but playing Plymouth was always just different, like Jeremy Bell, he was a hell of a player, trying to figure out how to guard this guy. And Dave always had the best scouting reports, because you can always look back at Dave and say, hey man, I did what you said on the scouting report. If he scores 30, that's on you, Dave.
Force him right. Every time.
Force him right into a fadeaway. That was the scouting report. But obviously, we had to have guys that, did their role, and we did that year. Everyone kind of brought into their role. Everyone brought a different quality to the team, and it worked well that year.
Oh man, my account on that is the same, but I'm going to tell the truth. First of all, we would travel down there, and how we used to travel down there. And our fans would remember that, because we used to have to travel down there in cars and how vans or whatever get there, get all of us come back because our turnaround. And it was a big stage. It was a big theater. It was a hard floor, cold gym. And they had this warm-up routine that everyone had to do that they had put on for their fans. And it was probably about my second, third season. I was like, that's it. We ain't doing this no more. So they wanted us to come out and join the warm-up and join their warm-up and for their crowd. And we had to stand in the cold in corridor for about 10 minutes. So it was this whole thing that we come off, go on, come off, go on, come off with the exception of four times, and it interrupted the warm-up. And they told us that that was the most important part of the basketball game. So, and every team did it. So finally, I turned around and I said, saw this, and I didn't use saw it. And I said, we're not doing this no more. And we're not going out. You see, y'all can go there. We'll sit here. We'll come by our bench. And they turned around and they told us we're the only team that didn't participate in it. You know, we should be a disgrace to the league. And I said, well, when y'all come up to Newcastle, we don't actually ask you guys to, you know, to practice with us, to work on us, you know, to work, you know, within our warm-up, you know. And, you know, they have in three locker rooms in the back, you know, just everything to dismantle us. So from that standpoint, it was like, we do not want to ever lose to Plymouth under any circumstances. And then usually after the game, they would get upset with us because we didn't eat their Cornish pasties.
Right.
You remember?
Yeah.
We were bad people because we wanted to get on the road. We wanted to get back. We had a 4-hour drive, and we didn't want to sit down with the opposing team or with the opposing fans to take part in eating their Cornish pasty. Yeah. And don't get me wrong, we do appreciate them providing it, but you know, it wasn't the
thing. Got a long journey.
We had a long journey, and you know, to get back into the season as it is the team that we had essentially we had eight players. We had and from the onset, I knew we were going to win. We was going to win all four, and I'm going to say it because Joe, the year before, came off the Achilles tendon. I was in the year before, had the pneumonia. Chuck was, you know, at that point in time. We were talking, we obviously, over the summer, we started talking to Tomo, and Tomo wanted to make sure that he came. So all we knew what we had. We had Darius, we had Bridgie, and I remember putting the team together, and we talked about myself, Paul, Dave. We talked about what we didn't have, and I looked at the team and I said, "Nah, this is it." And
we
the very
speed.
First practice,
speed. We found some speed.
Yeah. The very first practice that we had, it was on. We didn't talk about it, but we knew. And if my memory serves me correctly, I don't necessarily think we lost the game up until December.
Yeah, we lost to win the league. We were 24-3 when we won the league.
Yeah, and the game that we lost, I believe it was early in December, we were all upset because we knew we shouldn't have lost that game. And then obviously preparing for the cup. And I'll say it again, there is a format that we put together for winning everything. I know it, Forrester know it, and then a couple of our players know it. And I would even turn around and say, Joe knows it. Mm. And we were upset that Plymouth was putting themselves in our category.
Right.
And they weren't in our category because they didn't go through the trials and tribulations that we went through as a team. Because in getting a clean sweep, it starts the year before. It's never within that year. And you build a relationship with each other, with the team, and an understanding, and also understanding the game in and of itself. And it's almost like the stars are aligned. And you know when the stars are aligned, you know, the guys on the team know it. You get that feeling. And then when you have, at that point in time, it felt like we were always dusting teams off because teams were always putting themselves in the category that we were in, whether it was Sheffield, whether it was Glasgow, whether, you know, we Towers, or whether it was Brighton, or whoever it was, it was Thames Valley, Guildford. It was every year it seemed like it was a new team emerging that was trying to take or put themselves in the same category as us. And we all took that personally. And we took it personal when we were playing in the cup and we actually dismantled them respectfully.
Plymouth.
And then they came, Plymouth. And then they came back and they said that they lost that we didn't beat them, that they lost to us. And that set the stage for the trophy. Because in the trophy, we knew it was too late. It was almost like we were pacing ourselves throughout the course of the season because we knew what we had to do. We was just pacing and putting on pace, and we never did more than what we needed to do. And at that point in time, it was almost like we were playing and we would pace ourselves and we would get up and teams would come back, but they just didn't have enough to come back. But equally, we were making sure that none of us burnt out. We all actually knew our role, and it was almost a clock. The only one that we had to get to understand was Paul Gorse, because he was a rookie. It was his first year within the team, and he was extremely talented, and we needed him. And he always found himself within foul trouble. And it wasn't necessarily because of him. It was just simply because of him being a rookie. I already had Joseph mad under just because of his Achilles tendon. And coming back and people counting him off. I believe he came back in best shape of his life for a play, because people turned around and said we were stupid for signing him, for bringing him back. Would he be the same, whatever? So he had the chip on his shoulder. Chuck definitely had the chip on his shoulder. Worked out the whole long season. Darius had the chip on his shoulder. Bridgie had the chip on his shoulder. Tomo had the chip on his shoulder. I live with the chip on my shoulder. And then we have Forrester with the chip on his shoulder, from the standpoint of Forrester didn't like Plymouth at all. At all. So you put all that together, it was like, okay. And then you played them in the first leg, and they were so upset at us for losing the cup that it wasn't going to happen again. And all we knew was, okay, y'all really think y'all going to beat us? Like, all right, so we're just going to keep it close, because when you come to Newcastle, it's over. And we all knew that, but we never said
it. Yep.
Yeah, I think so. I think we let them get away the last minute of the first leg, we let them get away a little bit more than we needed to. I think it was a close game all the way through, and then they made a couple of plays at the end, and they got it out to 9. It was a weird bus trip back, because it was a long trip back, but there wasn't any degree of panic. Certainly at the front of the bus with myself and Fab, there wasn't any degree of panic on that way back, because, you know, we felt that the various things that they'd done, you know, Michael Ojo went off in the first game, and he hadn't, you know, because he was bouncing back from the cup final when he hadn't played much. And we felt that that was all stuff that we could handle and we could deal with, and that we'd be ready, and that they didn't really necessarily know what was going to be coming to them on the Friday. It was still tough because, you know, we had to beat them about twice on the Friday. We were up on them once in the second quarter, and they came back in the third, and we had to do it again in the fourth. But, you know, the weird thing about that team was like it was a schizophrenic team, because we started off with Fab and Joe in the backcourt.
Mm-hmm.
Basically two fundamentally solid lockdown defenders who, you know, we would take opposition guards out of their game early, and the ball would go where it needed to go, be it Tomo, be it Darius, or be it Charles. And then after about 4 minutes,
five-minute mark, we had Gorse coming off, in.
In comes Gorse, you know, and suddenly the whole team, the whole game changes. It becomes less of a grind, but it also is a total different environment for the opposition to have to deal with. And when Paul got into that, and when Paul played well that year, we were, you know, we were unstoppable.
Yep.
He, you know, when he played well coming off, if he got, he didn't get in foul trouble, his minutes were there, and he didn't really get healthy that year until kind of the second half of the game. But in both the cup final and the cup final and the trophy final, he played really well, and he just opened it up for everybody else because of his quickness, just allowed the floor to spread. And in the meantime, we got guys who are in the opposition's best players' heads because we got 2 6-foot-3 solid defenders in the backcourt, and then a lot of size behind them in Darius and Tomo and Charles. You know, it was a team that really just kind of clicked together perfectly the way it played.
We were just going out there and we were going to stifle teams on the defensive end. And the biggest thing that they would say at the start is that everyone always felt that we didn't have enough. We didn't have enough scoring, or we didn't have enough. And I think the fact that at the end of the day, I had Joe and I had Chuck. Man, with Joe and Chuck and their own, the ability to score from anywhere on the court at any point in time. And then we had Paul Goss, who could get to the front of the rim at any point in time. And then we had Tomo solidifying us with the size and, you know, being able to shoot. Bridget, court spacer. D giving us the little bit of muscle that we need. Man, that team right there was just incredible to have that. And then equally, as I said before, you know, I'll say it, turn around and well, for myself, as you know, because as a coach, you always have to think a little bit further ahead. And you know, I just knew that team were, because obviously we had the trophy, and it was a thing where, you know, once we won the cup, that we had to lock in on the trophy. And it was Plymouth, and the fact of the matter is we weren't going to let Plymouth hold that on us, because they had a team that they put together on paper, because they had the paper.
Right. They did that.
You know, so I think that, you know, for us, we took that personal. We really took that personal.
So we had a team of people who were kind of good at taking things personally.
Yeah,
and
it didn't take a lot to get people going. I mean, it can be someone in the crowd, it can be anyone, and we got that little click. Like, all right, it's time to go now. It didn't take much to get us going.
So, and Joe, if you could correct me wrong, you're the best thing that was for opponents or coaches or anyone to do for us is to be quiet and leave us alone. Because the moment that's
right. Yep. The moment you start talking, it's over. So we coming after you.
And it was all of us.
Right.
It was all of us. And it didn't take much. And I kind of remember at times we were in there. What? You looking at us?
Right. Like, all right, here we go. And it was another part where all the guys always tried to play harder because Fab is a player coach, and they always trying to look for jobs, you know, for the next year. So even Americans come out and play harder, you know, when they see Fab on the court, like, all right, I'm about to show this coach who I am. Fab turned it up a notch and like, hey, you can't play for us. You know? So it was always those little things that kind of made us go that year. And we, like Dave and Fab said, we took those segments in every game, in every cup or trophy. We only focused on that. We didn't say the league. We only looked at what was in front of us. So that's what made that year kind of special, is we looked at one thing, like, all right, we got to beat got to win the cup. That's done. We got to win the trophy. That's done. We got to win a league. Well, hell, now we only got to play for the playoff final. So we're not going to lose that. So, you know, so it's like it was just stages in a, you know, in that year that everybody just – it was this perfect blend of characters and chemistry that made it kind of special.
Yeah. The game I remember actually is a – the game I remember is actually thinking, wow, this is actually – we've got something going here, which really kind of solidified us. It was actually in Holland. We played – we did a Christmas tournament in Holland, and being the BBL, we got on the flight at 4 a.m. from Newcastle Airport, and we had to play at 4 p.m. in the afternoon against a team from Kazakhstan.
Yeah.
In that game, I think Fab and Joe got injured. The hamstring, and Fab, I think, I don't know what it was, it was your shoulder or something, I can't remember.
Groin.
So, and we lost that game to this team from Kazakhstan because, as I say, we'd been due to play at 8 o'clock, but they moved the game forward. So everybody was, there was no rest, there was no sleep in between. And then the next night, we had to come out to play again against what was described as the Nigerian national team.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the biggest, most physical team.
Yeah.
Remember?
Yes.
We had to beat them by 8 or 9 or something like that to get through. Otherwise, we'd have had 3 days off and a waste of time, basically.
Right.
And I remember throwing young Ross Wilson out there with all these guys, and it was just a brutal game. And Tomo and Darius and Chuck and Bridgie and Gores, and we somehow came through, and I think they got a cheap technical with about a minute to go, and we won by a point and by 9. And I think in the locker room after that, you know, just for a game that didn't mean anything really, you know, that wasn't significant in what we were doing, but I always remember the locker room after that.
Yeah,
you know, the commitment to winning that in itself,
right.
Made realize, hang on, you know, we got something going here, you know.
Yeah, I remember that too. And I remember also saying to you when we came back, because obviously we just did the cup game. Charles was about to destroy somebody because he was on an incredible role.
He played for
the moment. The moment that me and Joe went out, Charles took it to another level. Those last 4 weeks leading up into the cup, he just went bananas.
He played 4 games in that tournament, 4 games in 4 consecutive days, and he averaged like 28 points. And they didn't put him in the team of the tournament.
Right, I remember.
He didn't get picked.
Oh, he was mad.
And it was like, whoa, really?
I think that was important too for guys like Bridgie and Paul. They kind of found their way because me and Fab, we got hurt at that time. So those guys actually stepped up and played well. So that time when the cup actually happened, when, you know, I think you guys put me back in the starting lineup. When I came out is when those guys were like super comfortable. Like, all right, we went from like 2 to 4.
You played Milton Keynes a week before and you were hurt. And
yeah,
a good win down there. It's actually the game. It's on YouTube if people want to find it.
Yep.
It's actually there, that game. And certainly the cup final, you kind of took a half to get your rhythm back because you hadn't played for 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. And you're right. And Bridgie came in the cup final. He was awesome. Him and Paul in the cup final, basically, when Chuck had that little gap, there was just nothing there. And then the third quarter, yourself and Tomo stepped up, and Fab was basically defending everybody the whole time and making plays as well. It was great. We wouldn't have written it the way we did, but the way it worked, the way it did happen, it worked as well as it probably could have.
I agree.
I just wanted to make sure that we survived the trip, and the fact that we had the 2 travels, because obviously we had to travel down there and then travel back. So my whole thing was surviving the first game, making sure that you know, we got there on time. We got a good warm-up. Obviously, the gym was going to probably be cold. You know, it was going to have high rims. And, you know, they were going to throw their best shot at us. And my whole thing was, if it's not 20 points, they're going to lose. So I believe Forrester and talk about it, we just wanted to, you know, more or less control the game.
Yeah. To get out of there.
To get out of there as quickly as we can and not worry about the score, not worry about the thing. Just make sure that we control the game and not get it out of hand. And then actually, myself and Forrester tried to make sure that we paced ourselves to the point that we didn't go too much into the game and let our killer instinct take over and try and put that game away right then and there, because that was the one thing that I did not want us to do, was to try and put that game away to give them the motivation to come at us, or for us to have the mindset that we've won. Because there's a natural thing about the two-legged game, the team that's up always eases up a little bit, and the team that's down is always going to be the aggressor.
They're more desperate.
And play more desperate. And with it being two legs, the biggest thing that I wanted to do was make sure that we played the right tempo for the game. And we don't lose by anything. I figured anything more than 20 was going to be an ask. Anything less than 20, you know, it's fair ball game. We're going to have to play hard, but it's fair ball game. And I think that, you know, at different points in time, it was here and there. And I think
it was 9 again, but basically we controlled it until about the last 2 minutes, and you know, and they it just got away from us the last 2 minutes. They made a couple of plays,
and I do believe was it Joe that hit a shot to bring it back to 9 at the three? It was
no, that was a different game. That was the Mersey game the year before.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. Before we tied that on the buzzer.
Yeah.
The first leg there. No, it was, yeah, they because they, I think they won the last couple of minutes of the game and took it from maybe a 3-point game to a 9-point game. It made, certainly their crowd was quite triumphant. It was a bit, I don't think the players were. I think the players kind of knew that. I don't think the players thought that they were just going to walk up to Newcastle and win. But the environment around it, everybody around them, was celebrating like they'd won.
Yeah, that's true, Dave. But I actually believe they thought that they were going to walk up and win, because afterwards, when we come and we do our huddle, the one thing that you should never do to us at that point in time, any particular team, is after you win, celebrating too hard.
Yeah.
Because if you do that to us, and because the big thing that got me, used to get me the most, is that, you know, teams would celebrate wins against us as if they won championships, as if it was the championship game. And it would be, you know, okay, we bring it in. And it was almost like they were trying to rub it in. And I remember looking over, and I remember looking at us and looking over at our team, looking over to Joe. I think you remember that too, looking over at them. And like, oh, y'all, really? Like,
after okay. One leg?
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Okay. So I think seeing that, and then seeing that crowd, and then coming up, it just, and Dave, remember, rightly so, I think, you know, we didn't say much in the locker room. I don't think I said too much in the locker room at the end of it. You know, okay, that was their best punch. We know what we need to do. And then on the bus ride home, I mean, I can't even remember how we got back, but I just remember it was just like, it was a as Dave said, it was a calmness about, you know, the group and about the team. And I think you guys were back there on the bus, you know, Joe, and I think y'all talked about it, but didn't really talk about it. And,
right.
And you guys knew what you was on, because, you know, y'all will always have me and Dave would be up there strategizing. and you guys would be in the back with the war room.
Right.
You're a chump, you know, back there, war room, and it, you know, and like, how are we going to, how y'all guys are as players? Because yeah. I think I would, myself and Forrester would put the scout report game plan and strategize and how we were going to do it. And then I think when I came, you know, as a player, it became you guys talking about, okay, yeah, Fab, we got the game plan, but you're a player now, so, you know, forget that coach stuff. Right. You know what I mean? You say them tactics for them sidelines. You know, we in the trenches right now.
You're in the trenches. You know, you're ready to go.
In the trenches right now. So, you know, you get on board or get left behind. So, and I think that was the one thing that, you know, that I can appreciate is the fact that I was always – you know, the coach of the team. It was never the leaders. And then I think the players, yourself, you know, Charles, Bridgie, you know, years before it was your Lenards, your TJs, Drews, your whatchamacallit, you know, we had, you know, the various leaders and the leader of the team, and the team kind of took the identity of our leader of the team, and once we had the right, you know, the right leader, and at different points in time it was different peoples, but once, you know, we adopted that philosophy, our leaders would not allow us to lose any of those games. And I think in the past, I you know, as I said before, I was a coach, but I wasn't necessarily the leader of that team, and I think I was the organizer of the pointing in pointing a direction, and you know the team in and of itself, you know, took over, whether it was the likes of yourself or Chuck, and then even Tomo quietly, you know, and then, you know, abruptly at the end, and it was just like, okay, when one of us said something. You know, and Charles said it, when any one of us said something, it was almost like it was the gospel. Nobody took anything, you know, personal or whatever. If you wasn't doing your job, you was going to be told by someone, and it was just basically do your job type of thing. And I think that really solidified in us.
Well, we have got a great opportunity now to see all of that in action with the two legs of this this BBL Trophy Finals series from 2012. First of all, Joe, it's been great to have you back on the Nestin. Thank you for sharing the memories, and we hope that you and all your family and loved ones all stay safe, and we look forward to hopefully hearing from you again in a future episode.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this has been great. Obviously, you know, reminiscing and seeing guys is just a part of the culture that sometimes you don't celebrate and get a chance to do all the time. So this has been great. Go down memory lane, and hopefully that playoff final. We got to get to that too, because that was a good memory. I mean, we barely got past Chester in that semifinals, I believe. That was a battle. So yeah, I look forward to reminiscing and, you know, looking at these games.
Yeah, I think we got Thomas tipping as well. Cool.
Yeah, it was a challenging year, man, but it was fun.
Yeah.
Well, we got that game coming up soon, of course. Dave, thank you again for joining us and guiding us through that.
That's all right.
And Fab, thank you again for joining us from Canada today. We hope that you and everyone there stay safe, and that you're all well. And I look forward to hopefully hearing from you on a future episode when we get through even more monumental and historic games in the club's history.
Yes, pleasure.
Thank you guys so much for all the amazing memories, for joining us on the Nestin tonight, and just for the amazing insight into what it was like to be a part of this incredible Eagles team when we did the clean sweep in the 2011-12 season. So let's get into the action then. We start on Sunday, the 18th of March, 2012, away at the Plymouth Pavilions. And then we're back home at Sports Central on Friday, the 23rd of March, 2012. Just like in the Cup Final earlier on in this season, we are up against the Plymouth Raiders. It is silverware win number 2 of 4 in this clean sweep season. And what an amazing couple of games you've got coming up to watch. If you're on our YouTube channel, you're in the right place. If you're on Facebook right now, use the link in the description and jump across there to watch the games in full back-to-back straight after this interview ends. Stay home, protect the NHS and social care, save lives, and enjoy the games.
Well, 11, Anthony Martin. At 13, Thank you.
circle. I was in the flop.
Thank you. Yeah. We know what we have to do. We want to celebrate a couple of days and get our mind on basketball and come back on Tuesday. So focus back on the league and get ready for Bill McKinney. Thank you. Mr. Joe Chandler, Sports Central, your player coach, Fab Flournoy. Away I, man. First of all, I'd like to say yes to Bring Bob. I'd like to say thank you for everyone.
Yeah, like I said, they're a good team. They're going to make adjustments. Sometimes it's a blessing and a curse when it's a halftime coming up. So we really had to dig deep in the fourth quarter and get that lead back going and just pull out the victory. Got to give hats off to the crowd again. They made Ojo 90% foul shooting and missed 2 out of 3. And, you know, things like that makes sense. You have a great crowd.
If we came out with our regular game plan and coming out and playing some defense, we would be all right. First half of the basketball game, that's what we did, which allowed us to get the run on them. And then once we got up, it was about controlling the tempo and controlling the close of the basketball game. Great for, you know, the trophy final. And the first time that we celebrated a trophy, winning it on our own home court, make up for the 07 year, make up for however many years ago is when the Raiders came up on our own home court and beat us for the trophy. Yes, this gets to go. Obviously, the secret was out that we decided that we weren't going to shave until we won the trophy finals. So, you know, you can see all our players looking rough. You know, it goes off tonight. We got the Clippers in the locker room and, you know, in a shaving kit, and it all goes. Thank goodness for that. All the Wilds would be happy for that.